No Jumper, coolest podcast in the world. And today we're incredibly lucky to have the one and only Zero here on the podcast. How you doing, man?
Man, I'm blessed by the best. I'm good.
Blessed by the best. Oh, that's your signature slogan, huh?
That's my slogan.
How long you been rocking with that?
Man, ever since I knew I was blessed. You feel me?
Word.
Day one.
I also got it. Before we even say anything, I'm just in shock by the bracelet that you have on here. This is probably by far the best jewelry we've ever seen on the show.
Man.
For real.
It's his name around his wrist. That's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, man. You know, if they watch, you got to, you know, do some shit like that. Shout out to King. Shout out to King.
The wrist real quick.
Yeah, the Cheddar to Connect.
Before we even get started, too, I got to say that this is a long history of Southern rappers asking me to buy them expensive liquor. So we got the bottle of, this is what you've been drinking for years now?
That's what I drank.
All right, let's crack it open. We all got to take a shot to start this, right?
Man. Yeah,
let's do it.
By the way, I've never had this before, so this is going to be a totally new experience for your boy. So I'm about to see what Zero is sipping on, man.
Yeah, man. You know.
All my like player ass uncles down in Louisiana drink that. You feel me? I had to tell him. I was like, man, you'll never guess what I'm about to sit with.
Yeah.
I don't know. He's probably gonna pour a bigger one than me. When we had Gangsta Boo on here, she requested some type of vodka that they did not have at Rite Aid, so I had to go with the Grey Goose. But
oh yeah.
She still ran the bill up.
Said they did not have it at Rite Aid.
Hey, right, it's a good spot to go. So, I mean, we have a very young audience, I would say, but I mean, it's pretty crazy, like, how relevant you've managed to stay over the years. So I'm really just excited to be able to sort of introduce, like, our younger fans to, like, everything that you contributed to the game over the years and everything. So, for those who don't know, you're from Houston. Can we talk about who you were before you started rapping, before you started coming in the game?
Man, I was fucked up. Shit. I was doing all kind of shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was one of them nerd niggas, man.
Okay.
You feel me? I was in my books and shit. Yeah. And I fucked around but I was, you know, I was robbing people though too.
Okay.
Like I was taking shit. Like I was, like nigga lay it down. And I laid the wrong nigga down one day.
Shot
shit out
of
my ass. You talking about what, like 13, 14?
You got shot when you were 13 or 14?
Yeah. Damn.
So
first time.
How'd the scenario play out?
Shit, you know, you young, you don't know how to do that shit. You rob a motherfucker, take his shit, and turn your back and try to... I should have fishtailed out of that motherfucker, like, looking at you and backing up, but yeah. I turned my back.
Right.
And then blew my motherfucking back down there.
Where did he hit you?
In my back.
Oh, like right in the back. Okay.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So what was the recovery process from this like?
Shit, no more basketball. That shit, like, killed my... You know, I was young, doing some scholarship shit.
So you were talented in sports before?
Yeah, I was basketball, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I was basketball nigga, man. And, you know, I was in my books because, you know, you had to have your grade, a certain grade to play the ball.
Right.
Yeah. I didn't want to do that shit, but I like, shit, to play the ball, I got to do this nerd shit.
Uh-huh.
So I did the nerd shit. And, you know, I still played after that, but I fucked around, I got shot again, and, then I couldn't pass a physical no more. They'd be like, man, what's this hole and what's this big ass hole? Like, nigga, you're not playing for us.
Really?
Yeah. So
the second time you got shot, was it a similar situation?
Nah, the second time I got shot, it was a motherfucker trying to take my shit.
Okay.
And, you know, same shit damn that happened, except, you know, beat the motherfucker up and nigga shoot you from the ground.
Well, really? It was that kind of thing?
Yeah, it was that kind of thing. So it had to be rap after that.
So was it a direct, like, transition? You were, like, just, you had all this energy bundled up and you had to do something with it?
I mean, I was rapping the whole time.
Okay.
Because, I mean, why are you waiting to do whatever you do? Like, if you hustling or whatever you're doing, it's always music related.
Right.
If you out here, you know, on the corner, or if you, you know, if you in a trap or whatever, and you chopping, you know, you getting your shit ready for the next Vic or whatever, you know, music gonna be playing.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, niggas gonna be in that bitch like, nigga, I oughta did this shit like this.
Right.
Just start rapping over some shit. So I'm freestyling, you know, in that motherfucker just, you know, remaking, you know, songs from back then.
Right.
You know, I'm talking about back then. So.
Because we're talking like mid-90s or early 90s.
Yeah, we're talking about late 80s.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Yeah, we're talking about late 80s. So, you know. Raheem will come on like, nah, nigga, I do that shit like this.
Right.
And nigga get the rapping the way they rapping, just saying our own version of that shit over it. Mm-hmm. My shit was SWV. But I get so weak in the knees.
You would rap over that instrumental.
Yeah. Like, we out here hustling in these. I'm hustling on these streets. And, you know, just some shit like that.
Right.
And motherfuckers used to be like, nigga, boy, if DJ Screw heard you on some shit like that,
right,
bitch, you would be gone. Yeah. And I'm like, man, you know, yeah, whatever, you know, that's cool, but you know, nigga, let's chop this work up.
let's do this.
Yeah.
But so is it a dynamic where like you're selling drugs and you hear these motherfuckers talking about shit on the radio or whatever, and you're like, that's actually what I'm doing, and you guys aren't telling the story as accurately as I could. So that's what motivates a lot of people to get in the game.
Yeah, I mean, most shit that you hear, it's some shit about another nigga.
Right.
Yeah. You feel me? Like, it ain't too many motherfuckers that's smart that's gonna get up there and just, yeah, nigga, I just murdered Dave on the other street.
Dave. Yeah. Shout out Dave.
Shout out Dave. You know what I'm saying?
R.I.P. Dave.
You guys want to do the shots real quick?
You know, I've been sipping this shit, man.
Yeah, you gotta sip this.
Yeah, this thing.
If you do a shot,
brother culture.
If you do a shot, this shit gonna shoot you back.
Bruh, man. This shit good as hell, though. I didn't even know.
Yeah.
This the real.
It's in that like swimwear.
For a nigga that smoke weed, this shit is some, man.
It'll take you down.
It'll take you down.
It'll take you down. Really.
But so you're talking about rapping over the SWV beats and shit like that. So were you honed in on your ability to sing and to harmonize from a real early age in the rap shit?
I ain't gonna call it that back then. I was a note holder.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I hold that bitch.
Did you sing in the church or anything as a kid?
I did. Uh-huh. But I mean, that shit was like 2 weeks.
Right.
So, would you call it portrayed as singing, or like it was just like, yo, like it's your flow? You feel me? Because it's like,
what I do now?
Yeah. Period. Like back then, it was like.
Well, I don't know what the fuck I call it. I just call it me trying to do some shit.
Yeah.
Like, it was my style.
I feel you.
You know what I'm saying? I like melodies, and then a lot of time when you just straight rapping for a motherfucker like me that like melody, you know, that straight rap shit might get boring to me sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, I want to, you know, it's just steak. You got to put some shit on it.
That was crazy that she
some
said
seasoning.
That she would do the SWV, because it was like, all your beat selection is just so crazy with that.
Slow, and then you can bring the liveliness to it with your flow and shit.
Yeah.
So.
But
were you always the kind of person who was thinking outside the box, who was like capable, like even before you start rapping, who saw it like, I don't need to just rap like this, I can do something different? Because that takes a lot of confidence and courage.
I mean, I was doing that shit like that because I just didn't really hear it being done.
Uh-huh.
You know, I didn't hear it being done too much. Like in my era, you know, my favorite rap group was Street Military.
Mm-hmm.
And they was rapping on some, I mean, if you listen to the name, that's what the fuck that shit was.
Right.
It was a military of the streets. And they songs came across like that. And when they were rapping, like when KB rap, you know, KB a rapper, Pharaoh would rap, they flipped their song like Bone.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like no melody. It's just straight up, you know, reload,
right,
going in. So I was like, shit, I wonder how that shit to sound if I did that shit in a B sharp.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Did that bitch in a D minor, some retarded shit. And I'm like, my logo was like, I don't give a fuck if you like it. I like it.
Right.
Doing I'ma like this shit. And so, I was listening to my own shit.
Yeah. But was Bone a big influence on you? I hear you talk about him in interviews a bunch, and now they're on your new album, you collab with them a bunch of shit.
I mean, we actually only got that one song.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but I mean,
on the new project.
Yeah, on the new project, mm-hmm. But I mean, they definitely hold a place in my influences from an early age.
Right.
Like when Crazy will go off, or when Busy will go, and we're gonna miss it. Yeah. Like, you had to love that shit.
Right.
Yeah, because it was up until that point, you heard of the fast rap, but it was like Twista.
Right.
You know, just going like
it was like intentionally
like
technical.
Jawbone, like just jawbone lockup type shit. Like you just nigga ain't going. Like, damn, this nigga going.
Right.
Did they really have like a big influence on people down south? Like,
yeah, especially when DJ Screw got a hold to the album and slowed it down.
Oh, so you could really hear what they saying.
That tape was legendary.
Our shit was like, and I'm gonna miss everybody.
That sounds fire already.
Yeah, and then you hiding the bitch.
Yeah.
And then that shit coming on.
Vibing out to that shit.
Yeah, and then nigga like, and you know, back then nigga drinking that syrup
that
and
juice.
Shit. And you in that bitch just.
It's gone. You got to sleep.
And all of a sudden them niggas come on that bitch just get to just unloading, but it's slow.
Yeah.
Oh man. Man, nigga in rap form like a bad poem.
Yeah. That shit's fire.
So was your original group Gorilla Mob, was that your first like time that you had anything serious going as a rapper? Were you getting success on an independent level before that?
Man, I wasn't getting shit with that shit. You know, I did Gorilla Mob so I wouldn't get sued as a solo artist by this other nigga I was signed to.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and it was actually an album that I damn near had ready already.
Uh-huh.
But I took verses off, so this cat, you know, and this other cat, they put verses on the verses I took off, and then we came up with a couple of original joints too.
Okay.
And we put that shit together. But I mean, I say that was the first one that got any type of acclaim, the first group. But I was doing shit like way before then with niggas. I didn't know they just waiting on a nigga hit some platinum or something so they can drop that shit and roach like everybody else. But that was the first one that actually got noticed a little bit, especially down south, because you know, Screw, like me and Lil Flip were the last inductees into the Screwed Up Click, period.
Okay. Wow.
But, and Screw was like, yeah, nigga, I need this Gorilla Mob shit, this Keep Watching Me shit, this Fungin' in Maine shit. Like, I need this shit.
So was that what caused him to reach out? Was he heard you on that project?
Nah, his brother heard me freestyling at a club one night.
Okay.
And his brother was like, nigga, you dope. And I was like, cool. He like, man, my brother want to fuck with you. The fuck is your brother? You know what I'm saying? DJ Screw. You know, I'm just, nigga.
Right, your brother.
Yeah, right. Nigga, get the fuck out of here, nigga. And nigga like, nah, he might, all right, nigga, I'm finna call him. And I just, hello? That nigga say, know what I'm saying? And I'm like, ooh, this nigga right here, yeah, man. This nigga, man.
Because he's larger than life to you at that point already, right?
Yeah, because I'm like, shit, I done slid through the house a couple of times, and you know, in South Park, you know, we over there, you know, really to steal cars and shit. But in between stealing cars, we'll go over there and buy some Screw tapes.
Right.
With the money we'll get out of niggas' cars. So, you know, you slide by, this nigga got a hole, a gate. It's just a house.
Mm-hmm.
And motherfucking lines all the way up the block of just cars waiting on 10 o'clock.
Really?
It's 9:40. I promised it, man, it's 76 cars.
The cops would not be having that these days.
Shit, they wasn't having it back then. They wouldn't have kicking in the door and shit. What the fuck are you selling?
Yeah.
That nigga say, dope. Dope mixes.
Man, right?
And that's what it was.
Right.
This man Screw making $8,000 a day off of mixtapes.
It was that crazy.
Yeah.
Shit.
It was
that crazy.
And so when you got in there, who were you surrounded by? Was it all people you were looking up to already?
Man, yeah, a bunch of the niggas that was making me nervous.
Yeah, for real.
I'm walking that bitch, just like, oh, my shit. Oh, this Big Pokey? I ain't saying shit. Oh, Big Mo? I ain't singing shit.
Right.
I don't want to do shit. I just want to sit in this bitch and be a fan.
Right.
Nah, nigga. Get your ass on the mic, nigga. Man, my throat hurt. Like, I ain't doing shit. And I'm just in there watching that shit. And I got to see that shit in its true form.
Right.
Screw coming out. He see the average nigga going, do they mix and then slow it down. I'm going to show you how OG do it. Slow this shit down and did it.
Oh, so you rap over the slow
beat. He
did
it the other way too, but just, you know, showing off. Nigga, this how we do it. Don't, 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 don't. I'm like, man, this nigga about to make, you know, you be sitting there like, I'm chilling. But on the inside, like, I'm finna go off in this bitch. Like, I'm finna murder somebody in this bitch.
Right.
And I'm like, I couldn't hold it, man. I got on the mic and killed that Eminem beat, that Crumbs the Brick shit, and yeah, that shit was crazy.
But so, did you have your confidence up at that point? Like, when you think about yourself back then, how evolved were you in that sense? Like, in terms of being able to go around a bunch of guys you respected and be able to rap? Like, the first time you had to do that, how did it go?
I mean, my heart was beating like a motherfucker. But at the end of the day, I was like, I really don't give a fuck if they feel my shit or not.
Right.
I feel my shit. You know what I'm saying? If a nigga don't feel my shit, he ain't touching it right.
Right.
No homo.
But you already had that, like, internal confidence kind of going
for
you.
Nah, I ain't
right?
have it. I had an attitude.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm because, I mean, down there, man, where I'm from, man, ain't no love.
Right.
Nigga going to ridicule you if you the greatest. Nigga going to hate on you regardless.
Right.
So, I mean, I wasn't giving a fuck about being accepted. And a couple of them niggas was hating too.
Yeah.
Screw, he rapping too fast. Nigga, Screw was like, nigga, you listening too slow, nigga. And that's what that shit was.
Right.
But I mean, I ain't give a fuck if they was on it or not. I was like, I'm on it.
Right.
Screw liked it. I liked it. I'm like, shit, nigga, you ain't Screw. I don't give a fuck. Yeah, Screw liked the shit.
That's all that matters, man.
That's all that matters.
So yeah. I heard this story you were telling on another podcast where you're talking about how the first time that he got you to rap when it was just you two was also one of the first times that you got really fucked up on lean.
Man, it was my birthday tape, actually.
Okay.
Blue 22.
What at 22?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Ooh. Yeah, Blue 22, man. And I was actually asleep before this nigga pressed record.
Man.
Yeah, it was the first time it was a paint. And I'm like,
what was
you
sipping?
Shit, I could tell you exactly what I was saying. A 3-liter pineapple from Randall's. Yeah, that bitch was 3 liters. And I had been drinking like probably the 4 was the most I've ever drunk in a 1-liter with somebody.
Oh, right.
Man, this nigga came in there and put this whole paint in his 3-liter. And he was already fucked up. So I kept waking him up like, hey, nigga, let's do the tape. He like, go get that shit out the freezer first. Got that shit out the freezer and pulled. And it's like Minnesota was pouring so slow, man. And that shit. And I drank like a whole cup before we hit record. By the time he did the R. Kelly song, the first song on my tape, I was snoring. This nigga put me on there snoring like a motherfucker.
Were you in love though, right there and then?
Man, I couldn't afford that shit.
You want to be in love with her at that point?
I wanted to be, but financially, I was like, man, I'm going to go back to drinking 3s and 4s. I can't drink no 16s.
Yeah, bro.
That shit wasn't even that expensive back then, but that's just how my life was back then.
So you don't do it anymore?
Nah.
Well, at what point did you quit?
Shit, when I started wanting to get a whole lot more money.
Uh-huh. Man, I feel you. But you thought it was holding you back?
Nah, I didn't think it was.
You knew it was?
I mean, shit, when you blowing like 28, 30 grand a month on this shit.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and then feeding all these roach ass niggas around you who can't pay for it, they want to drink your shit.
They always want to pull that act and they can't pay for it.
I'm thinking I'm making 70 grand a month. I'm like, man, why I can't make 100 a month?
Yeah.
Bitch, you is making 100 a month. You spending 30 on this shit. Because you really spending like 25 grand on the shit, and you spending 5 grand on cups and sodas.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, man.
5 grand on like, sodas and cups. That's serious shit right there.
Yeah, it's serious. It's serious.
For real,
that's crazy, man. But when was that? Because it's like the prices are all crazy now. Like, I'm assuming that when you quit, they probably weren't crazy like they are now, right?
Nah, they were crazy.
Oh, okay.
And that was one of the things that made a nigga quit.
Yeah.
Man, because in Houston, it get the worst on the tax.
Right.
That shit went from, in my day, from motherfucking me $25 a line, where you could get a 4 for $100, then you get to $175 a line, you get to $12.40 a paint.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, I'm getting the paint every day.
Yeah.
I'm getting the paint every day.
Right.
You know, give or take 4 days relaxing because I'm still drinking on the paint from yesterday.
Yeah.
And as many motherfuckers as it is in here, everybody that's how many motherfuckers' man. Cups I'm paying. So I'm really not getting the chance to enjoy the whole shit.
You're a nice guy. Nobody's pulling anybody up around here.
Nah, I wasn't nice. I wasn't nice. I'm finna make you do something, though.
Yeah.
Oh, we going to the show, nigga. You finna hold the camera, nigga.
Right, yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You finna, hey, and then you knock niggas out, you knock out bitches, and you watch for the police. Like, everybody gonna do something.
Yeah,
right. Them niggas was gonna be with me anyway, so, you know, fuck it.
So how many years in there did you have with Screw that you were under his tutelage and working with him
man,
before he passed?
Got to, I started kicking it with him at the end of 97.
Okay.
98 is when I got in there. So it was all of 99, the end of 98, all of 99, and up until November in 2000.
Okay.
Yeah, so it was real short.
Right. But during that time period, what was it like for you? Were you just feeling like you were just learning and just being productive as fuck? Or what was your mind state?
He was just telling me to keep doing what I was doing, mm-hmm. because of the results. It was kind of like, he was like, man, this shit sounds real good when you come off on my mix, because you flipping your tongue, you rapping fast, you holding melodies and shit. You know, everybody else in there was rapping like, you know, I'm not trying to be biased or nothing, but everybody was rapping like how Southern from my neck of the woods do. Man, mm-hmm. hold up, syrup in my cup.
Right.
I'm coming dying, yeah. Fucking on the yell on the south side of town. I wasn't rapping like
you
that.
You came out with the sorrow and the yeah. tales of the yeah. craziest shit. Yeah.
Yeah, tall tale of a G and shit like that, you know. Gotta get my pimp on, you know. I'm singing shit, niggas supposed to be rapping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and I thought that was gonna be my lane, that, you know, that'd be different.
Right.
You know. Cause my shit was like, fuck it anyway. Like, if you ain't like my shit, you know, fuck you and your mama anyway. Like, I don't care. You know, that was my shit.
Yeah, no, really.
So, and being like that makes you want to be outside of the box.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I look at motherfuckers like Andre 3000 and be like, okay, I'm not gonna be like that.
Right.
But I'm gonna emulate that though. Yeah.
The creativity and this willingness to step outside the box.
Yeah. You know, you gotta let your nuts hang, man. And you gotta let them shits scrape behind you when you walking.
Right.
If you a man, you know what I'm saying? Yep. And I'm like, shit, nigga, everybody got a fan.
Right.
The wackest shit in the world got 1,000 motherfuckers who will support that shit.
Case in point with these two. Yo. But so I wanted to ask, like, did you feel like wait, what the fuck were we just on? Fuck.
I had a question. When did you get to the point where you really started seeing like mainstream success, and you started seeing like not just the people from your hood or from your area fucking with you, but you like, goddamn, like everybody fucking with me?
I mean, man, that's a tough one because I ain't never looked for it.
Yeah,
you know, I'm just doing my shit. But
you're in the eye of the tornado at the time. Yeah,
yeah. But I mean, I started realizing that people were fucking with it when other rappers were letting me know they were fucking with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, like when, you know, Nipsey will say something,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying? Ross will say something.
Yeah.
BLB, you know, bring a nigga to Atlanta to come work in, you know, mm-hmm. Tree Sounds with him and shit. And just motherfuckers from everywhere. Like even when Beyonce brought us to do some shit.
Damn, really?
And Jay was like, my motherfucking brother was like, "Hey man, Jay, this is my brother." Nah, nigga, he hot. I already know. He just put a nigga shit front page with that "No Justice, No Peace" on title.
Damn.
The other week, so
really,
I know. I realize what it is. Damn. I don't be tripping on that shit or nothing like, cause you know, I might be a jerk, but I'm humble. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for real.
But it's not what I wanted. I want everything. Yeah. You feel me? So I haven't really seen. So I can't really properly answer your question.
Yeah, no.
But I mean, I know people fuck with it because I see the numbers and shit.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't just really seen it with my own eyes yet. Yeah.
Let me ask you this: what was it like your actual experience with Screw passing? Like, how did you find out, and how did it change your life?
Well, the day he passed was actually the day he requested some wax from my album Zero Versus the World.
Okay.
And he wanted to chop and screw my song Too Many Niggas,
uh-huh.
the first one. And the day my wax came in was the day they found him dead.
Really?
Yeah, and my CEO at the time, Den, he called, he was like, "Ro, I gotta tell you two things." I'm like, "What?" He like, "Well, number one, your wax came in, we can supply the DJs, and Screw just died." And I'm like, shit. Like, it's, and it affected me on a personal note because out of all the people I had been kicking it with for years up until that point, he felt like one of those.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Even though, like, label mates who are real friends.
I mean, you know, Screw didn't want to do no music business. He just brought you to the crib, put you on the mic if you wanted to. If not, poured you a cup. If not, you was just in there because you was cool. Like, the dude was just a light, man. You know, he was just he was really a magnet.
Right.
And everybody was drawn to him and shit.
He seemed like a real artist. Like, he didn't give a fuck about the business shit so much. He just really wanted to create.
Everybody was trying to make this nigga do screwed up entertainment. He was like, nah, nigga, I don't want to be in charge of nobody. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, I don't want, like we going to get money together regardless.
Uh-huh.
He wanted to do them tapes. But nigga freestyle, I don't know what his financial relationship was with nobody else.
Right.
But I do them freestyles on the tape, and he'll line my pockets and shit sometime. And I'm like, and he was giving me way more than I would be expecting to get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not like shit. But I mean, we ain't miss none of that shit when he passed.
Right.
But when he passed, it was like, I knew two things. I was like, well, the rap scene finna be something different. The camaraderie on the South Side, it is withered away now.
Why, he was keeping the peace?
I mean, yeah. Because, I mean, every big name that came to School Crib was some hot rapper from another neighborhood.
Right.
Yeah.
You had Yellowstone, Big Pokey, Hersherwood, Lil Kiki, Dead End, you know what I'm saying, Fat Pat and Big Hawk. You know what I'm saying? You had ESG representing what, Glenn Hollow or some shit. You had everybody was repping their neighborhood and that motherfucker. You had Mike D representing Third Ward, you know, KK representing, you know, Dead End. You know, it was a lot of niggas in Dead End. You had the Botany Boys representing Botany.
All
these different neighborhoods, like in the South.
Dudes that might have been fighting if it wasn't for him bringing them together?
I mean, probably not fighting, but not, definitely, I mean, never united to do some shit together.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Then you had nigga like me, you know, bringing in my neighborhood was just famous back then for, you know, getting shot or going to the other side of the water and living big in that motherfucker.
Uh-huh.
And the bad yellow bone bitches in there, that's what the fuck most city was famous for back then.
Right.
You could come get your dope off without the jump out boys taking your ass to jail easily. And I mean, by me coming over there, you know, it linked me up with everybody else.
Right.
And that's what school was. It was like a safe haven.
Uh-huh.
You know, niggas had problems with each other.
Yeah.
Trust me, you know, because a couple of them cats in the Dead End Alliance was rapping about each other.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? The same fucking group.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
that's,
you know.
Crazy.
Yeah, but so I knew the game was finna be fucked up. Then I was like, ain't nobody gonna keep it real no more.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, and of course, personally, I was hurt because I was kicked, like, I'd be every day damn near.
Right.
Every day.
So how'd you go about, like, your process afterwards?
Reinventing the creative process,
I mean,
right?
Nah, I mean, I never lost the creative process.
Yeah.
I just didn't create for a little while.
Uh-huh.
But, I mean, for the couple of years that I had with Screw, we didn't just do our music.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Like, I'd be over there really kicking it most of the time.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it wasn't all about, hey, Screw, I'm here. I was thinking about this. Run this beat, run this 12 with it, and let me rap. Like, nah, it was walk over there, go up to the freezer, pull that shit up, find somewhere to sit down, if you can find somewhere to sit down.
Sit.
You didn't have seniority with getting a seat by that point?
I mean, it wasn't no seat. That's the whole thing about it.
Yeah. So
it wasn't shit in there. Like, it was the studio.
Right.
You had, like, what it looks like here. You know, you had your mixer, you had the 1200s, the speaker set up, you know, all that shit. But shit, that was it.
Yeah.
It wasn't no couch. It wasn't no motherfucking cover in that bitch. It wasn't nothing. You feel me? Like, that was what it was. It was,
you
know, came
in the refrigerator.
Rap, yeah. The refrigerator.
Yeah, the refrigerator.
But yeah, so from your perspective, is it like a total tragedy, or is it anywhere related that, like, the Houston music boom sort of coincided with Screw's passing?
I mean, nah, I mean, we was getting ready to bubble anyway, because everybody started dropping records.
There
was
so many stars
time.
In that scene at that time. Yeah,
yeah. You had
Paul Wall,
Lil Flip. You had Lil Kiki was doing this shit on a smaller, big level.
Yeah.
Fat Pat had just died 2 years before that, but Ghetto Dreams was doing great.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You had Mike Jones, Slim, you know what I'm saying? All that shit was going on.
That's a crazy time period when you think about it. Like, to have that concentration of people that, like, had, like, obvious star power to all be coming out at the same time, it must have felt crazy. But did you feel like you were a part of it, or you feel like, in a way, it was different?
I wasn't a part of it because the people I was doing business with wasn't thinking big like that.
Okay, yeah.
It's kind of like I went to some places with some big shit, but I wasn't never really a part of that boom because my albums and the people I was doing my albums with, I feel that really wasn't doing what it took and put my shit in the proper places to be discovered. Like, you do a dope record, and you'll put that motherfucker out.
Right.
But if it's just on the shelf, like, did you put that motherfucker out?
Right.
Don't nobody know about it.
Yep.
You know, it's like having a kid coke and not telling nobody. How you gonna sell some shit?
Yeah, it's common sense.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right. For real. So did you? Yeah. It's well, you're talking about rap a lot when you talk about not being promoted right and shit like that, right?
No, I'm talking about the earlier. Like, when that boom hit,
right?
I mean, you're talking about, you know, 2000,
right?
2001, 2002. Nah, that rap a lot didn't come to like later on,
right?
Yeah. I'm talking about, like, I'm Straight Profit back then, KMJ Records. Mm-hmm. You know,
booming around the South, yeah, like all around Louisiana. Yeah. That's what my cousin, that's when I was out there for my family reunions, and I remember first hearing that. And my cousin just had this tape, and I was just like, what the hell is this? Because, you know, I'm from LA. I'm like, what the fuck? I hear this, and I hear your melodies, and I'm just like, what the fuck? That Slim Thug, all that shit. And I was just like, this is some other shit. And I'm young, so I'm like, wow.
Yeah. And, you know, my shit wasn't on the level of what all them was doing back then.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they had songs about cars and shit.
Shit like that, but it was
hoes.
It was really about the
Tupac shit.
Yeah, really telling about the hood.
So, yeah, that was a big inspiration for you, Tupac? Because I could definitely immediately see the comparison point right there.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I think everybody got a little pop.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, definitely, you know, like, strictly for my niggas.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, strictly
but
for my
niggas.
You're
mad at Me Against the World, where he really started bearing his soul.
Yeah, that's where it just started at, on the cover with the glasses on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm listening to that shit on the low volume, on the sneak tip in my dad's house.
Right.
Low volume.
Yeah, on low volume.
I got to ask this before we can even move on. Like, was Scarface a huge influence from you early on? Because especially with you being willing to talk about darker things and everything, and especially because you guys still work together today, I always felt like you guys were just obviously, you were influenced by him as an older guy.
I mean, I didn't listen to too much Face back then.
Oh, okay.
I listened to K. Reno.
Okay.
That's who I listened to. That's the greatest motherfucker, in my opinion. Ain't nobody else. But, you know, I listened to a Lil Face. You know, The World Is Yours album. There's some bangers on that motherfucker.
Right.
But I was on, you know, Stories from the Black Book.
Uh-huh.
K. Reno. Like, once you listen to this nigga, like, no disrespect to Face, that's my big brother.
Uh-huh.
But, man, K. Reno is kind of like, you know,
inspired him.
This is that Louis versus that sandal.
Yeah, I feel you.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, like, this nigga here is, yeah, man, like, when you on some, like, he's on intellectual shit.
Right.
He ain't on no creases and no jeans and no bad bitches. This nigga's, you know, telling you what Shakespeare wrote in the Bible and shit.
Right.
Like, yeah, he on some
other shit.
He on some grown man shit. Like, put some fat on your brain type shit.
Right.
That's the type of shit I like.
All right, so I'm from the East Coast. I'm 32. Can you guess what the first time I heard of you was?
I can't guess.
It's when you had some fucking bars for my man Curtis Jackson. That's where a lot of people, I think, on the East Coast, you know, I didn't know about Zero until you had some words for he was the top dog at the time.
Yeah.
Can you just give me a little bit of background info? I know nobody likes to dig up old beefs. I'm sure you don't give a fuck about him anymore, but how did that play out from your perspective?
I mean, that shit was just a simple, I'm going to say blind loyalty type shit.
Exactly. Yeah, that's, I always got that feel.
Yeah, because it's like I'm the new guy at the label. Mm-hmm. How do you tell somebody who feeding you, like, you're not going to do this?
Right.
So it's like, hey, man, this is what we on.
You were supposed to be
right
the shooter
now.
At that moment.
I was the shooter. I was, like, in real life. Right. So it wasn't nothing to be it on no shit where I ain't really had to shoot nobody. Like, oh, this is easier than the norm. So
right. Yeah.
It's like, get on here and, like, And usually I ask my people, like, what's the problem with them? Cause like in the streets, a nigga be like, hey man, can you handle some, like ride with me over here? Okay, why though? What you did though? Mm-hmm. Okay, you fucked that man, girl. I ain't going over there for that shit.
Yeah.
Go fight that nigga. If he knocked your teeth out, I'll buy you some more teeth.
You didn't even bother to ask with this one.
Nah, because it's like, yeah, it's like I went to sleep on a pool table for the last 3 months.
Right.
And I got a bed now and a house and shit. Somewhere I can bring bad bitches to and feel good about. Like, I can't bring the bitch to the 8-ball.
Right.
You feel me? So,
to the 8-ball.
Yeah, you can't bring a bitch to the 8-ball. You know what I'm saying?
So,
you know, but it's like, well, fuck it. What you want me to do?
Mm.
Do this here. And I'm like, I'm like, shit, I don't know who the fuck this nigga is. I'm like, but besides what I'm hearing on the radio.
Right.
But besides that, I'm like, man, who the fuck? But shit. This a nigga who's making it possible for me to, I ain't gonna ask no questions.
Yeah,
for real.
So did that have like a noticeable positive influence on your career at that point? Because somebody like me from the East Coast was all of a sudden listening to your shit?
I mean, I didn't know you was listening to my shit. I ain't know nobody was listening to
you
my shit.
You probably sold like, a few more albums up in New York and shit. You probably saw the shit.
But you're, back then at that label, you weren't gonna know what the fuck said.
Yeah, for real.
Different time period, huh?
Yeah, you weren't gonna know what the fuck was going on.
Right.
Because the performances didn't get to reach that far.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I was barely busting Texarkana.
Uh-huh.
You know, I'm on the Texas, you know, Arkansas border.
Right.
Going that way. And I'm at I'm in Louisiana going that way.
Man.
And I'm in motherfucking San Antonio going this way. I'm like, I ain't went no motherfucking way. That's all I'm seeing. Waco, Austin,
right,
Lake Charles, Lafayette, you know what I'm saying? Little Rock, Waco,
you're in your own Austin. World, yeah.
You know what I'm
right
saying?
Back. You didn't know shit about Queens right then.
Man, shit. Nah, I ain't know shit about Queens.
Hey, but did he ever like respond directly to you? He ever throw bars at you?
I don't know if he did because I've always listened to just me or K-Reno. If he did, I ain't hear about it.
Right.
I wouldn't care about it because I'm like, see, naturally, if somebody go for me,
right,
I'm going to go for them.
Uh-huh.
If it's relevant enough.
Like right.
If it's some whack-ass motherfucker, then nah, I ain't going to say shit.
Right.
I can make this nigga famous, but, you know, I ain't know, though.
Yeah. So... You sound like you kind of got burnt on your first deal. Did you, like, feel like you got jerked on your subsequent deals, like, especially after Screw's passing and everything? Did you feel like you didn't really ever get into that proper label situation that you deserve?
Nah. I mean, most people down where I'm from don't.
Right.
It's just, and I ain't going to even say burnt. It's just motherfuckers don't know how.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like with the dope man mentality, a lot of people don't think about the real.
Right. The fact that you are in this for life once you sign this contract.
You feel me? Like, I'm on some shit like, okay, I'm thinking about my legacy.
Uh-huh.
These motherfuckers thinking about the returns.
Right.
How many returns are we going to have? We don't want to spend money to repress this. So if a nigga dropped 100, mm-hmm. a nigga want to make back 100. Then make a, you know, the percentage.
Right.
Then start splitting money down. Then that's the last time you're going to hear about some shit. The first time you hear about some shit is the last time you're going to hear about some shit.
Right.
That's how motherfuckers do that shit down. So unless you're too shorting it out the trunk and doing it yourself.
Man.
Which I was doing the whole time. I wasn't seeing the results on the label side, so I burned my own shit.
That's what I was.
You were bootlegging your own shit.
Yeah, that's exactly. Like, that's what I was finna ask you about next.
Respect.
So look,
yeah.
So when I would drive down there from back and forth, I would see your tapes in the liquor stores, in gas stations. You know, Extra Miles out there, they sell Boudin and shit. So I'll go there and give me some Boudin. You know, I see your tapes. So I wanted to know about that.
I mean, a lot of this shit wasn't me. A lot of this shit was
just like random, just bootlegs, yeah. Just going around. Yeah,
that shit'll go around. I used to ride around, try to look for them niggas too.
Catch them, no real shit.
Yeah, slide that bitch ass up under their own car.
Man,
yeah,
I take out. Yeah,
you had a few situations like that.
Yeah, about 67.
The bootleggers back in the day. That should have to be like the ultimate beef that you had as a rapper, huh?
I mean, nah, it was like a come up. It was a Debo moment.
Yeah.
Nah, you've been sitting out here doing my job for me. I'm finna come take your shit So thank you for the cooperation. You feel me? I'm like, it was really easy because if you're the dude on the bootleg, you don't want to actually be out there yourself.
Right.
Because now you're looking broke.
You're the guy who don't want to show his face. Yeah.
Yeah. You want to have a street team.
Right.
So nigga be like, hey, man, down Fondren and West Airport at the Kroger. Nigga got a bag of your shit and he been moving them.
Right.
Okay. Let him sell them all. And when he leave, just tell me where he park at. Just park behind a nigga and just, you know, put the nigga in his trunk and take everything.
Nigga in his own trunk.
And you know, a nigga probably done made about $600 or $700.
Right.
With your face on it.
Yeah.
Because they'll really have your whole mixtape cover on there with the slip. Like, it's really
crazy.
So
that's my money. I just take that shit and ask a nigga, you know, niggas, shit, you can get this indigenous reservation in the trunk or you can go in the house. You know what I'm saying?
Take our little ass home.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny is that he was on another podcast I was listening to talking about how when a motherfucker talks shit on Instagram in his comments or something, that he's not afraid to look at the profile and take that mental note and be like, all right, I'm going to see you. It's like the same thing. That's a modern equivalent, right?
Yeah. That's exactly what it is, man. Because, I mean, motherfuckers think they safe and they can say
anything.
Does that happen?
Have you seen a nigga and recognize him from like, really? That's lit.
Nigga, and I like that he's so high profile, but he's so, because he's real comfortable doing the enforcer role, the you know, step
you gotta
to the
be your own shooter.
Let him know, like, you got to live up to your words,
you
right?
Be your
I mean, you got to be a man, you know what I'm saying? And now, as a man, I'm going to hold you accountable
for
what
you
say.
For your word.
So if you say I'm a bitch-ass motherfucker, I ain't tripping.
Bet.
But if you say you a bitch-ass motherfucker with some adverbs and, you know, adjectives behind you, and you're gonna do me as some type of verb when you see me,
right?
You're gonna have to hold that up.
Well, you look at his profile and it says he lives in Germany, you're like, all right, whatever. But you look at his profile and you're like, he lived downtown. Like,
I mean, I ain't gonna go looking for him,
right?
Yeah,
but if I turn around and I,
that's you.
That's Mr. Slippery when not wet.
Bet.
I'm gonna beat your bitch ass up. Like, I'm a
Mr. Slippery.
Yeah, I'm gonna be like, hey, what's up, player?
What's up, Mr. Slippery?
You good?
But I know how you're doing. You're stepping into him like the dad role. Like, you're not gonna just beat him up. You're gonna make him say sorry.
Nah, I'm just gonna beat him up.
Oh, you're gonna beat him up.
Hey, this nigga wrong. Street nigga.
Yeah. I ain't getting paid to teach a nigga right from wrong. Shit. But I mean, shit.
Oh, you're gonna teach him for sure. You slide him.
Nah, because ass whoopings don't work.
Ass whoopings don't work.
It's
no
like
more
Pac
at all.
Say, maybe they're listening in their casket, man. Like, ass whoopings don't mean shit, because, you know, 2-3 weeks, that shit gonna go down.
Heal up.
Yeah. Motherfucker gonna be back in the mirror like, hey, I'm back talking shit, nigga. Yeah, nigga, re-fuck you.
So, you know. Fuck you part two.
So can we ask you a real question? Because you're like an older gentleman. You know what's right and wrong in the streets and everything. Do you look at the younger generation and do you just feel like, man, like the kids are fucked up. The internet has them doing wrong. Is that a big feeling for you?
Man, I don't even give a fuck. I mean, it's like, man, because people going to be people.
Hey, word to man.
I mean, I won't say that the young people fucked up. Mm-hmm. I say parenting went wrong.
Okay.
And I'm not saying music-wise. I'm just saying about everything.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? The lack of parenting from both sides, the male and the female, and bad parenting.
Right.
Because, I mean, you can come up knowing right from wrong, and, you know, I ain't saying be no sensitive ass bitch, but at the same time, you know, motherfuckers say shit, and you know, they think motherfuckers ain't gonna hold them accountable for it.
Right.
Motherfuckers be wondering why they be getting murdered and shit.
The internet fucked them up, huh?
Yeah, man. It's that talking shit from a safe place syndrome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, nigga, I'm in my room.
Yeah.
Nigga, fuck your mom.
Fuck man, you going up?
I'm gonna slap you, you bitch.
It's very funny.
Yeah.
It's real funny. Cause
it's
your
real funny.
On. Yeah. It's like, I be laughing.
But I mean, and then a nigga who gonna come find you, that nigga ain't got no life.
Right.
Yeah.
You
for
can
real.
Say anything you want to say on that motherfucker, but the nigga that's actually gonna just, I'm going to drop a pin on this nigga's location.
Yeah.
I'm going to find this nigga. You know what I'm saying?
Like, oh, yeah. No, that's too much.
That's a bitch nigga.
Yeah, that's a bitch nigga.
But you know, I catch you.
Hey, Uncle TK, man.
Yeah, my man, TK over with High Effect 2020. Okay. Just coming through with a high-quality pre-rolls. What's up, TK? Man. You got them bags with him?
Okay.
This is for you, man, all this.
Okay.
So I be in Houston, man, in the squats.
Shout out TK, man, coming through. He's going to have it. Hey, I know you've been smoking for a long-ass time, but this shit might put you on your ass. These things will fuck you up real quick.
Oh, that's what's up.
Yeah, hey, you know, TK, you got to throw me the pack on camera. Appreciate they love that shit. All right, it's all good, yeah.
Man, my nigga.
Appreciate you,
bro.
TK, man.
Bet.
He's a good guy right
there. Yeah, I'm going to be fucked up. Them shits are strong.
Those shits are, because they got the moon rocks in them. It ain't like normal ass weed. It'll have you on the floor,
I smoke some of that shit.
I have one question about one of my personal favorite songs. How did that throw song come along with you and UGK and fucking Jeezy and fucking... Wasn't Jay-Z on that song too?
Yeah.
Did you record that in the studio with everybody together?
Fuck no. I was the new nigga. I couldn't meet nobody.
Yeah. Wait, you didn't even record it with UGK?
Nah, Pimp was in jail.
Oh, damn.
Whose song was this? It was supposed to be somebody else's song at first. Yeah. And you know, Mike Dean was like, man, come over and do a hook. I was like, all right, cool. I come do a hook. And I heard the motherfucker come on. It was like, da-na-na-na, da-na-na-na. I was like,
this shit's
dope. So I was like, I was asking Mike Dean, like, man, how the fuck do you come up with shit that you come up with? Because he was already a legend at that point.
Yeah.
So I was like, man, how do you come up with shit? And he said, first, I was tripping off Mike Dean because what he looked like.
So you thought he was a white boy, so you didn't really trust him or what?
Nah, I ain't know the nigga was white.
Okay. Oh, you said that in another interview. You're like, I thought he was going to be a big fat black guy.
I thought he was going to be like Earl Campbell or something. But that nigga was like, you know, like an insurance salesman and shit. But with long ass hair, though. Yeah. So I was like, it fucked me up. And I was like, that's you doing all that shit on Scarface record? Yeah. Like, yeah, that's me. So I'm like, well, man, how you come up with shit? He said, I just take whatever the fuck I'm doing there, and I match my feeling. So I was like, I was looking at what I was doing. I was like, I was smoking some good weed.
Mm-hmm.
I was drinking some good drink. And I think I had about I probably had like $18,000-$19,000 in my pocket at that point.
Always a good feeling.
So I was like, good weed, good drink, big money.
There you go.
Looked outside, I thought, okay, rolling in something, farming on leather, gripping grain.
Right.
And I'm like, shit, nigga, I handle my business, nigga.
Mm-hmm.
I deserve this shit.
Right.
So that's how the song came.
This is the ultimate question, though, and I know you're probably kind of tired of answering it after all these years.
I like this shit.
But the Mo City Dawn freestyle must be really fucking weird for you to have a random-ass throwaway freestyle from your perspective just become arguably the most iconic thing in your whole career.
That shit's crazy.
You must be tripped out by that, right?
Because I fucking hate that song.
I know you do.
I
love it so much, but I can see why you don't like it, because it's not like everything else you've
done.
Yeah, you know?
it's kind of like when you go out your way to be an intellect,
right?
And a motherfucker like your dumb shit.
yeah.
You feel me, nigga? Like the shit that has no substance or form whatsoever.
Right.
I like it because it's me. But then I'm like, damn.
The feeling was just there. Like,
the feeling is there.
When you recorded that, like, what were you doing? Were you in a particularly good state of mind? Did it stand out to you as I was having a good day that day?
No, I was turning myself into jail the next day.
Really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So did you feel like that might have had some kind of effect?
Nah, I was always going to jail. I ain't really give a fuck.
That's
like,
real
I was
talk,
like,
real talk.
Yeah, it was the beat though.
Right.
It was the beat. It was the Eric B. and Rakim, but it wasn't.
Right.
It was something slightly different.
It was all switched up. Yeah.
So I'm listening to it, I like, you know, slow line banging all in my trunk. And I was just doing some dumb ass, some crazy little rhymes.
Right.
And I looked at the nigga, like, man, go to the end. I'm like, fuck. I gotta do this whole long ass nothing shit.
Right.
And I did this whole long ass nothing shit, and I went to jail. When I came back from jail, they took this shit off my mixtape and put it as the first song on Let the Truth Be Told.
Right.
Wow.
And that's when people started hearing that motherfucker. So I was like, man, I guess.
You ever been to Acapulco? But you could if you wanted to.
Yeah, right. Now. Yeah.
I think I said it wrong too. It's always like hard for me when I sing along.
Yeah, Acapulco. I ain't. You know, I got there, but I ain't. It was one of them detours.
Yeah.
And you know, all these niggas flip. Everybody get off the plane. Mm-hmm. Get off. I'm in that bitch on that drink. I stayed on.
But does it trip you out that you could be performing that song to a bunch of, you know, 19-year-old girls from Houston that know all the words? Like, why?
See, that's
why,
great, because that shit keep a nigga relevant.
Right.
Because of that, they're going to check out my other shit.
Right.
Because once you, one familiarity, man, motherfucker accept all your shit.
Right.
And if not all your shit, the other shit that feels like this one.
Uh-huh. Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I kind of know the game a little bit.
Yeah. So do you look at Drake's cosign on that as a big deal? Or it was already legendary as fuck before that. That just kind of breathed new life into it, right?
This just let me know that Canadians fuck with my shit.
It let me know. I let that. You know you was touching the light skin niggas too.
Yeah, I was touching the Urns niggas, man. You know, I was, like, it was cool. That shit was
Urns.
Cool. Yeah.
Shout out OJ the Juice Man. He always been saying it like that. I love that shit.
Yeah, me and OJ got a song too.
Yeah, really? On a new project?
Nigga, that shit on my phone.
Yo, a lot of rappers' best features are on songs with OJ the Juice Man. I'm totally convinced, man. He's just he had energy about him. I love OJ, man.
It is
him,
man. And we got two songs.
Hey, you gotta play those for you. You don't gotta play it on the podcast.
I'm on the Googles before we. I gotta check those out, man.
Yeah.
Now
you
say you got them on his phone.
Yeah. With that aren't out.
One of them is.
One of them is.
Okay. I got so many songs. Hold on, man. I'm having an old moment. I gotta remember the name of the song. I am the streets.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the name of that shit.
Man, OJ's the streets.
Yeah.
Man, you're the streets too, buddy.
I'm not even going to ask you how old you are just because I heard you talking about how long you've been in the game. My man, you look fucking 25, my man. You look better than us.
He ain't touching 40. I looked at the Wikipedia earlier. Yeah,
I'm
you're
open,
killing
man.
The game, man. You're killing
man,
it still.
Good young pussy keep you young. Young pussy keep you
You've got multiple baby mamas. Have you? You've tried to be a good guy and get in the relationship multiple times.
Now that's the problem because I ain't never do the relationship part.
Yeah. You want to have the baby, but you don't. You want to be able to keep doing your thing.
Nah, it ain't even that. It's just motherfuckers go retarded after you fuck them right. You can't like my nigga Mike did tell me, man. My nigga Mike did tell me, man, stop going to the bottom, man.
Okay.
You go to the bottom and the bitch is over for you.
Uh huh.
As soon as you just, man, when that bitch look at you and her shit is like on some vibration shit and she, oh my God. When that oh my God come, man, your life is ruined.
So fuck her bad. Give her like.
You got it, man. You got, but
you
then,
gotta give her
as an entertainer, if you fuck her bad and she get on Twitter. Let me tell you about this nigga.
Small dick, 2 minute man.
2 minute ass nigga, curled up like a bitch after he nutted ass nigga. You know what I'm saying?
She
like
Cat Stacks, you film you laying in bed and shit.
Man.
They never got you with that, huh?
Hey, man, if they do,
it's a wrap.
I'm gonna need a bun. You feel me? I need a bun.
Thank God Cat Stacks never came at Z-Bro. That would be fire.
Nah, I don't fuck around.
Wouldn't even.
I don't fuck around, man.
That's a funny mental image.
The motherfuckers was cool. In the beginning.
Right.
But then a lot of motherfuckers have a baby for you and feel like, oh shit, right. I'm finna own this nigga. And I'm like, bitch, I'm not no property hoe.
Right.
Yeah, for
so,
real.
You know,
but you never been married though?
Nah, I ain't gonna never ever be.
You could never see yourself settling down fully.
I bet not.
Okay. That's good. Because I'm 32 and I'm kind of thinking the same thing. Yeah. I might be fucking these hoes for life. Yeah.
Not that either though.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, because fucking them hoes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, damn, man, that shit make you old quick.
Right. Where do you draw the line? Like, where is the what's the middle then? If we not getting married, if we ain't fucking these hoes.
I'm in my shit by myself with my kids.
I don't give a fuck
that shit.
I feel that.
Bitch come through, hey man, I just wanna bust it up. Bitch bust it. And then bust your way back to your house.
Damn, I feel that.
You feel me? Like that's cool.
You ever been pimping ever in your life?
Yeah.
Yeah? When you were younger?
I mean shit. At times, dabbling when the dabbling is necessary.
Is it tough for you with your personality, or is it, it
nah,
fits kind of natural?
I don't love, you know, because it ain't no love, no way.
Right.
So it's easy to just set up, you know, do that.
I was in a situation like that recently where I realized that a girl kind of wanted me to pimp her, and I'm like, I don't think I want to introduce that into my life. That seems like a little too much for me.
Yeah, she introduced that money into your pocket, though.
You're right. That's what I realized.
That's the best money, man.
A few bands.
I don't know personally, but
we all want to know.
I would assume that's the best money.
Man, money is money.
Sorry. So this is the big question: is how the fuck do you still sound fresh on a record after all these years? How do you still maintain your relevance? Given that, you know, a hip-hop career is supposed to definitely be done by your 20s, you know, but you're in your mid, late 30s, and you're still just, you sound relevant as fuck. You still get on, you know, younger dude songs doing the hook or whatever. Like, what do you credit for that relevance?
See, man, if you really live in that shit you're talking about.
Right.
I mean, how can it be hard? Like, it's... If I was talking about some shit I've never done or some shit I don't do on the regular, I imagine I'd sound fraud as fuck. Mm-hmm. You know, but I mean, if you're still living, I mean, even if you change your shit, if you deliver that shit to paint this picture vivid enough to let a motherfucker understand what you're saying, then, I mean, you'll always be relevant.
Right.
Like, I ain't put on a tight pair of pants yet like these young cats. You know what I'm saying? I ain't had to get on the track and moan yet and make noises and shit. I still do. I've been able to talk about bitch-ass niggas and hoes and haters for damn near 20 years.
Right.
It's just every time I do it a little different than the last time.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I just, you know, paprika this time, lemon pepper next time.
Right.
Man. Garlic butter next time.
Yeah.
You feel me? And then, you know, sometime give them some shit. Give them some El Pollo Loco type, you know. Mm-hmm. Change that shit up, you know.
But so, okay, this is the question, though, is you listen to somebody like Future and think that he's sort of a indirect descendant of what you were able to introduce into the rap game with you being willing to draw the line not so distinctly between rapping and singing and looking at guys who are able, who are big now because they were sort of able to take maybe some of that confidence that you had in that style.
Yeah. I definitely see the similarities.
Right.
With a whole lot of young cats, it seemed like everybody now, even though it's auto-tune, with like a lot of them, with a lot of the, you know, smaller cats trying to be Futures and whatnot and trying to sound like him.
Right.
But I mean, like, definitely, like, I know where the influences came from that. Cause I ain't gonna say I was the first, you know, Bone.
Right.
You know, to my knowledge, was the first motherfucker I heard do that shit at high rates of speeds with the singing shit or rap with the singing shit, period. So I took that shit and did it my way with the shit I was talking about, and somebody took that shit and did it their way with the shit they talking about.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, I respect.
Is there anybody you fuck with on like an underground level that you see in Texas or even outside of that you respect what they're doing?
I mean, I respect to the most part what everybody doing.
Right.
If they doing something.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because they could be doing some other shit. But I mean, it take nuts to do this shit and actually push it, because a lot of people know they trash. So they'll just rap that shit and just have that shit like, all right, we getting high. Man, let me let you hear my freestyle.
Right.
He ain't no rapper.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The nigga who's doing that shit, and every time you see it, like, hey, nigga, hey, I'm on some shit. Check my shit out. Hey, my nigga, I'm on some shit.
Yeah.
Hey, little mom, check this out, though.
Yeah.
Okay, that nigga is destined to do something.
Right.
Because he's, you know, he confident enough to try to make motherfuckers pay attention to it.
But do you have the time to, like, work with, like, younger artists and stuff, or do you not really like doing the A&R thing?
I mean, nah, I would never do that shit because I'm too busy doing my shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I do collab all day. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, unless, you know, I went to the doctor and this nigga told me, hey, man, the voice going to be gone Tuesday after next. You can't talk at all. Okay, all right, well, I'm going to do some shit like that then.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, as long as I got this motherfucker, shit, you know.
You don't look at a lot of younger rappers and think that they can hold a candle to what you got going on, vocally at least.
I mean, I don't never look at it like that.
Right.
Man, I'm lying like a motherfucker. I do look at it like that sometimes, but that, you know, that type of shit don't matter.
Hey, what was the moment where you sort of realized, like, oh, I'm kind of becoming the hook guy. Like, I'm kind of becoming that dude that people are going to come to and they want me to do their hook and make their shit sound smooth. When did that sort of occur to you?
Man, when everybody started trying to get a hook.
So early 2000s-ish, or?
I'd say by around when Scarface started asking me to do hooks.
Which you still do for him, yeah.
Yeah, like with Burn, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Burn, or like the latest shit with the one with Do What I Gotta Do with Nas, right, Ross, mm-hmm. and him, or the other one with FaZe and Ross that, I don't know what the fuck that is. Every time I turn around, I don't know the name of that shit.
I forget, but yeah.
Yeah, that bag or some shit.
Uh-huh.
Like when major motherfuckers start talking about, I want to, you know, get a hook from you. And then all of, you know, the local level people, like when you check your email and everybody want a hook, like it's by like 9-10 verse legs, but it's like 30 motherfuckers want hooks.
Right.
Yeah, you kind of realize then.
You're starting to think, like, maybe I got the juice, yeah.
Yeah, I got the juice.
Mm-hmm. That's what's up. I just wanted, like, last thing that we talk about before we wrap this all up. I love, like, in the Where the Real video, the one that you just came out with. Like, number one, that's probably one of the best songs I heard from you in a minute. But I really like that skit that you did with the motherfucker with the fucked up teeth trying to give you the CD and everything. What are your, like, tips for when you deal with, like, motherfuckers coming up to you on the street trying to give you their 35th mixtape and all that shit?
I don't do that shit.
You don't even tolerate it?
Nah, I don't. I'll be like, man, I ain't even Quincy Jones like that.
Yeah,
like, I can't help your shit. I'm still doing my shit, nigga. I'm an infomercial, yo, and I'm doing that for my shit.
Right.
So I'm like, yeah. Man, a lot of times, like, I'll accept that shit from niggas I know. I'll, like, you know, get that shit and put it with the rest of that shit.
Right.
Listen to it if I can, but I'm like, shit, nigga, I can't do nothing for you.
You're in your own world.
Yeah. I've always had this philosophy where it's like, if it's good enough, you'll come around and hear it anyway, am I right? Like, you don't really, like...
I mean, if I do, it's going to be, on some old shit type shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm too busy doing my own shit. Yeah,
and at exactly. the end of the day, what are you really going to do with it anyway? You ain't going to run around to a bunch of labels trying to get this kid a deal off one song, and it really... Mm-mm. It's too much work, yeah.
Nah, I ain't doing that shit, and I'm too busy doing Zero.
Yeah.
Yeah, for real, man.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm.
Where'd you get the name Zero from, by the way?
Shit, from having that.
Yeah? I feel that.
From having Zero.
Yeah, because I was listening to you talk about sleeping on the park bench when you were a kid and stuff. That's a fucking crazy story.
Yeah, shit's crazy. Everybody got one.
Yeah.
For real life.
But so that's another thing about you that I noticed, though, is that you seem like you're a dude who's not so disconnected with how thankful you are for the position that you're in and everything like that. Like, how do you still kind of maintain perspective on, like, how lucky you are to have been able to make a life for yourself doing what you love doing?
I mean, how can you not be?
Yeah.
You feel me? When you see it every day.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I be like, I make light of a situation. You know, my manager, you know, that nigga going, nigga, you tripping. I'm like, man, I don't like this house. Nigga, you tripping. Like, what you gonna do with the bench? Yeah. Nothing. Nigga, you tripping. Like, you know, see, I know I'm blessed.
Right.
Yeah, I know.
And you still, you don't surround yourself with the yes men. You still got people around you that'll tell you when you're tripping or whatever.
I don't give a fuck what they tell me I'm tripping or not. That nigga here be telling me I'm tripping sometimes. But you know, shit, I might be tripping, but fuck it.
Yeah.
I trip sometimes.
Yeah, you earn some tripping for yourself.
Yeah, you heard that, man? I've earned trip.
You hear that? He's like, yeah. No,
he turned the other way.
Yeah, I have earned trip stivity privileges, man. Huh?
Yes, man.
What yes, man? I ain't got no yes, man.
He looks like he's kind of mad at you. What happened over there? Yeah, we got a little domestic dispute here.
He light skinned. He light skinned, man.
Hey, leave a comment if you're light skinned. Zero. Thank you so much for coming in. You know, we had you and DJ Paul in the same month. We're really doing the whole thing, like covering all the legends from down south. This shit is crazy, man.
This is real crazy.
We are on all different
stages. Let's get a quick cheer. Hey, this shit got me twisted, man.
Yeah, you don't have to drink a lot of that.
Hey, I did this whole podcast. We barely smoke any weed, man. We drank, man.
Yeah, congratulations, Hess. It's like you might have conquered your addiction. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, so Zero, thank you so much. You're promoting the Drinking and Driving album.
Drinking and Driving, yeah.
That's the main thing you're promoting at this point. that though?
Drinking and driving, man. Go get that motherfucker wherever you can get it.
I listened to it all day today, three different times. I was meaning to go back to your oldest stuff, but I got stuck on the new album. So hey, we out here.
I got stuck on I Can't Leave Drink Alone. That's what I got.
I bought that 25 lighters. You feel me?
Yeah. 25. Yeah.
You feel me?
I was the 25 lighters. I was looking at it on Rap Genius for some reason, and I was clicking on it.
Because you're white. That's why you're
looking
at it.
Yeah, because I'm white. So I was on Rap Genius, but it said like they would hide the drugs inside the lighters. So that's why, because I always thought about it just like, damn, I got a lot of fucking lighters because we were smoking so much weed.
That's actually what I thought too. Yeah. I feel stupid.
It goes a little deeper,
Wait, how? Wait, I need you to elaborate on
because
this.
Because you could pass somebody a lighter, it don't look like nothing, but if it got some drugs in it, then.
How you gonna put drugs in the lighter?
You can break the shit open.
My nigga, I feel oblivious right now. I didn't know this was going on.
You are oblivious. All right. Damn. Hey, Zero, thank you so much. This is No Jumper, the coolest podcast in the world. Shout out. Check us out on YouTube, SoundCloud, iTunes.
All that
appreciate
shit.
You, man.
Check
thank
me
you so
out
much
on SoundCloud.
For honoring us with a moment. And to any of the younger viewers out there, make sure you go hit your Spotify, hit your YouTube, whatever it is, and give yourself a motherfucking history lesson about this man right here.
Man. Thank in you there so like much, swim bro. Well, chats.
Let's get it.
Tell me I can catch with you. Can you give them your social media tag?
Oh, I put it on the screen.
God damn, that shit
got
me twisted, man. I have like one, I have like a half a cup of it.
Hey, Adam, pass me that weed. I gotta smoke.
You gotta push up, man.
Yeah, I gotta smoke it.